From the late 1800s to early 1900s, high-quality coal mined from the southern Colorado coalfields was sought after by the steel industry for its use in railroads and other industry. These coalfields were located east of the Rockies, near the southern border of the state, and included a cluster of towns and coal camps along the Colorado and Southern Railway. 75% of this coal was mined by the Colorado Fuel and Iron Company, owned by J.D. Rockefeller. The southern coalfields were home to the bloodiest labor strike in U.S. history, known as the Colorado Coalfield War, with the most devastating event happening in Ludlow. A mine town and United Mine Workers of America tent colony attacked by militia and burned during the Ludlow Massacre. Miners employed by Rockefeller died at twice the rate of the national average, as they were working under dangerous conditions and the company had little accountability to the miners and their families. They were also always under the watch of company guards, who were privately employed by Rockefeller to exercise control over the miners by harassing and bullying them. Miners lived in company towns like Ludlow and were paid in company scrip, meaning they were only able to shop at the company store. Hours were long and wages were little, and over a 30-year period until 1914, 1,700 miners were killed in Colorado at the mines. But due to unfair legal practices, only once was the company found to be at fault. In 1913, the United Mine Workers of America had organized much of Colorado, and across the state, the union kicked off a large-scale strike, attempting to improve working conditions and wages. 90% of miners participated, which was about 10 to 12,000 workers. They moved out of the company towns and into nearby tent colonies, sponsored by the UMWA, which were strategically located near mine sites to discourage or intercept potential strike breakers, or scabs, who are miners choosing to work during the strike. Ludlow was the largest tent colony, with 200 tents and 1,200 miners and their families living there. For obvious reasons, the strike was not well received by Rockefeller and the company guards. Rockefeller hired additional private security to intervene, and they ended up tormenting miners at the tent colonies even more than they had before. They would shine high-powered lights at the tents throughout the night and patrol the edges of the colony in a custom armored car called the Death Special, firing randomly at tents and killing at least one person and injuring others. When the strikers fought back, the governor called in the Colorado National Guard in an attempt to calm the situation. But it only got worse, as the private security guards teamed up with the National Guard, and as a unified force, they ramped up the violence. They charged cavalry at families, jailed miners and rounded them up into bullpens, destroyed tents, and were responsible for beatings and other injuries of miners. This continued for 6 months. The violence finally reached its peak at Ludlow in April of 1914, just after the miners had celebrated Easter. In the morning, around 9 a.m., a group of miners were discussing an organized armed resistance to the guards with Lewis Tychus, who was the union leader at the camp. From a perch at Water Tank Hill, the guards could see the armed miners congregating, and in response, they had a machine gun brought up to the hill. Three women at the railway depot saw this movement and ran to warn the colony about a potential attack. Already in the mood to fight, a few dozen miners took strategic position along the railway cut in front of the colony. Tychus ran towards the guards' camp, waving his arms, hoping to get their attention and prevent a confrontation. But at the same time, the guards on Water Tank Hill detonated two rounds of dynamite as a warning to the miners, which was interpreted as an attack, and a firefight commenced. The hill fired upon the railway, and others charged into the colony, killing miners and setting tents on fire. Because of the months-long harassment from the guards, many families had dug pits into the ground under their tents, and would hide in them in order to avoid stray gunfire. This would prove tragic during the massacre, though, because as the fighting took over the colony, one group retreated to a pit, only for the tent to be set on fire above them. With the heat and smoke, they were unable to escape, and two women and 11 children were suffocated. After about 14 hours of fighting, 21 were dead, and Tychus was found shot in the back. It's said that Union members' bodies were found years later in the foothills, either shot during battle or trying to escape. After what happened at Ludlow, Union members in other colonies were enraged and moved to attack. For 10 more days, they attacked mines and company facilities, looted company stores, and fired at mine guards. The strike itself continued for 7 more months, with an estimate of 200 total dead, including miners, security, and National Guard. In December, the fighting came to an end, and the United Mine Workers were defeated. However, the press attention after Ludlow forced Rockefeller to undergo a huge PR campaign, and the strike ultimately set in motion a trend towards labor rights, which would eventually earn us demands like weekends and the 8-hour workday. In 1917, a monument at Ludlow was erected in memorial of the massacre, which is still there today. Ludlow continued to mine until the 40s, and it's unclear when the town was abandoned, but the post office was closed in the 50s. Today, a few buildings remain in the original mine town, in addition to the monument nearby, the pit where the children died, and the railway,